By 1969, Elvis had long left his lasting impression on the music industry as well as Hollywood. With 30 movies under his belt and a staggering number of gold records to his credit, it was time for Elvis to return back to what he considered to be the most fulfilling part of his career, the part he had been craving for the past several years, live performances. Still basking in the tremendous success of his recent NBC TV special, Elvis knew in his heart that he was happiest on stage, performing to a live audience.
I just missed it. I missed the closeness of an audience, of a live audience. So just as soon as I got out of the movie contracts, I started to do live performances again.
In December of 1968, the negotiations began with Elvis's manager, Colonel Tom Parker, to bring Elvis back to live performing again in Las Vegas, Nevada. Multi-millionaire Kirk Kerkorian offered Elvis a deal, accepted by the Colonel, to appear in a brand new venue that was yet to be built. The International Hotel was soon under construction in the heart of Las Vegas. Elvis flew from his home in Memphis to view construction of the massive new hotel and its showroom that would be the largest in Las Vegas. When the negotiations had ended, the agreement was for Elvis to perform for 4 weeks, 2 shows per night, 7 nights a week. His salary was $100,000 a week. From this, Elvis would also pay his band and backup singers. The contract gave Elvis the option for a second engagement at the International and allowed for the filming of a concert documentary. Colonel Parker refused to allow Elvis to be the first person to perform at the International. He knew that with a new showroom and new sound equipment, there were bound to be several little problems, and he wanted someone else to work out the bugs before Elvis premiered in this historic comeback performance. Barbra Streisand agreed to christen the International with its first engagement. Although the ball was in motion for the greatest comeback in the history of entertainment, it was taking care of business as usual for Elvis. In January of 1969, Elvis began his recording session at American Studio in Memphis, just a few miles from his Graceland home. This legendary session produced such hits as Suspicious Minds, Kentucky Rain, and In the Ghetto.
It's a little too hard for that quiet part, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess so.
The significance of these sessions is that it not only produced some of Elvis's very best records, but also gave him a fresh batch of brand new material to introduce to his live audience in Las Vegas in the near future. The recording sessions were complete in February, and without missing a beat, Elvis was back in Hollywood to begin his last feature film, Change of Habit. After he was released from production, Elvis was finally free to concentrate fully on his much-anticipated comeback in Las Vegas. Elvis himself helped to hand-pick the band that would back him in Vegas. After his impressive work with Elvis in the studio, James Burton was selected to not only play lead guitar, but to lead the group that was being formed. Burton was a guitarist with Ricky Nelson on the Ozzie and Harriet show in 1957, and a member of the band that performed weekly on the TV show Shindig. He was one of LA's top studio musicians and the perfect choice to back Elvis on stage. One by one, more members were added to the group. Larry Mahoborak on piano actually performed with Elvis in his charity performance in Memphis back in 1961. From Dallas, Texas, drummer Ronnie Tutt joined the group, and from Los Angeles, bass player Jerry Sheff and rhythm guitarist and RCA solo artist John Wilkinson came on board. Elvis personally contacted the Imperials to provide the male vocals and hired the black female group known as the Sweet Inspirations after admiring their work backing the legendary Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. Pleased with the musicians and voices that Elvis feel will bring the sound he's looking for to the show, rehearsals started in mid-July of 1969. The very first rehearsals took place in RCA Studios on Sunset in Hollywood, and included only the rhythm section of the group. Over the course of the next week, over 150 songs were learned by the band. Rehearsals continued a week later with the backup singers in Las Vegas at the newly constructed International Hotel. Barbara Streisand invited Elvis to attend one of her final performances. Upon seeing Miss Streisand alone on the large stage from the audience, Elvis commented to a friend that it looks like a hell of a stage to fill. As Elvis was contemplating his own performance on that very stage, he was reminded that he would be far from alone on stage with his army of musicians, backup vocalists, and a full orchestra. When Barbara Streisand completed her engagement, the rehearsals continued for a few more days in the spacious showroom, along with a 30-piece international orchestra led by Bobby Morris. In the meantime, Colonel Parker was working his magic with a massive advertising campaign that was so encompassing, he commented to Elvis that even the gophers in the desert will know you're here. On July 31, 1969, Elvis performed two complete dress rehearsals earlier in the day, and then performed for a third time in the same day at the actual 10:15 opening night performance. Moments before going on stage for this historic comeback to live performing, Elvis was almost overcome with a severe case of stage fright. As the opening music roared out, Elvis burst on the stage, bringing the audience to their feet with delight. Opening night was by invitation only, and the celebrities arrived in droves to see the greatest show on earth, and remained on their feet for most of the performance. Elvis was back and reclaimed his rightful title of the King of Rock and Roll. After the tremendous success of the opening night performance, Colonel Parker wasted no time outlining the terms of a new revised contract. In the hotel coffee shop following the performance, on a stained tablecloth, the Colonel scribbled down the new contract. Elvis's salary was raised to $125,000 a week. The International Hotel is given the option to include two engagements a year for the next 5 years. This guarantees Elvis an annual salary of $1 million for the next 5 years for only 8 weeks of work per year. Just to put things into perspective, in 1969, the median household income in America was just over $8,000 a year. The average couple would have to work 125 years to match what Elvis would make in only 8 weeks each year. Following the opening night performance in Las Vegas, Elvis held a press conference. He stated that he made his decision to come back to live performing 4 years earlier in 1965, but could do nothing until he finished up with his movie commitments. He also said that he chose Las Vegas to launch his comeback because it's a place that people come to from all over. Elvis later said that this had been one of the most exciting nights of his life. It was obvious that Elvis had the itch again. Performing to a live audience was in his blood, and his career was soon to take a creative turn. Elvis decided to go back to his roots. Las Vegas had become a launching pad that would soon propel Elvis across the nation and into the hometowns of fans from sea to shining sea. Before the end of Elvis's first engagement in Las Vegas, a deal was made with the Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo for Elvis to perform at the Astrodome February 27th through March 1st, 1970. As the Vegas engagement continued, RCA set up and taped several performances in preparation for the future release of a live album. After a few performances, Elvis became more comfortable and less nervous with each show. Free from the restrictions and bonds of a Hollywood script, Elvis felt free and at ease to talk to his audience between songs about his career, how he got started, and anything else that was on his mind.
I'd like to talk to you a little bit, ladies and gentlemen, about how I got started in this business and when. A lot of things have happened from my side of the story. There's been a lot written about what happened from everybody else's side, but not from my side. So, my nose running, my eyes are running, my ears are running, everything. Could have some more. I started out as a child. No, wrong, wrong. Thank you. I started out when I was just out of high school, and I was driving a truck, and I was training to be an electrician, and I got wired the wrong way, baby. That's what happened to me. I was driving a truck one day on my lunch break. I went into a record shop and made a record, you know, just for my own use. I wasn't really trying to get into the business. And the guy put the record out about a year and a half later. And overnight in my hometown, people were saying, you know, who is he? What is he? Is he? You know. And I'm saying, am I? I didn't know. So he got to be pretty big in my hometown. And then he got to be pretty big in certain parts of the country, but nobody really knew who I was, you know. So I started working in little nightclubs and little football fields and little alleys and little weird rooms with little things crawling in the ceiling looking back at you. And I did that for like a year and a half. And then in 1956, I met Colonel Sanders, Parker. So they arranged to put me on television. And at that particular time, there was a lot of controversy because you didn't see people moving too much out in public. They were getting it on in the back, but out in public, you didn't see it too much. So anyway, I went to New York to do this Steve Allen, Jackie Gleason. Boy, just a matter of time, man. The brain goes, the body, everything. The Jackie Gleason show. So I did three of the Jackie Gleason shows. You know, I'd never been out of my hometown in my life. So I was in New York, clearing my throat, and they said, well, get him out of here, you know. What's that? Oh, smoke. That was a spook, a ghost. So anyhow, Lord have mercy. So anyway, I did the Jackie Gleason show three times, and I was in New York. I had sideburns, you know. 14 years ago, it was really weird, you know, walking the street with sideburns. Hair, get him! Hot now, he's a squirrel, man, you know. I'm done. I'm like, people wonder why I shook so much. I was, yeah, you know. So anyway, what was I? I did the Jackie Gleason show three times, and then I went to the Ed Sullivan show. And Sullivan, you know, the cameras were photographing me from the waist up. And Sullivan standing over there saying, son bitch, you know. I'm saying, thank you, Ed, thank you. I didn't know what he was calling me at the time, you know. Then I went, I did three or four of the Ed Sullivan shows. And then I went to the Steve Allen show. And they were gonna tame me down, you know, so they dressed, what's that? Oh, smoke. Oh. They dressed me in a tuxedo, you know, and I'm standing very still, and they told me not to move. And I'm singing to a dog on a stool, you know. I'm saying, you ain't nothing but a hound dog. And the dog's going, So I'm watching the dog, you know. So anyway, the next move was Hollywood. So that goes to the mouth. What was I saying, man? Oh, the next move was Hollywood, yeah. So I went to Hollywood, and I wasn't ready for that town, and they weren't ready for me, you know. So first of all, you get a hit record, and you go on television, and then you go to Hollywood. That's how it happens. So I was out there, and, you know, it was all new to me. I was like 19 or 20 years old, so. It was all exciting, and everybody was saying, hey, Mr. President, you know, Mr. President, zombies, you know. So I did Love Me Tender and Loving You, Loving Her, Loving Anybody Get My Hands On at the time. And then my health was failing, my mind was going bad. So then I did Jailhouse Rock, And they told me to clean up the act, man, really. General House Rock, and then I did King Creole. So I'd done four pictures, and I was, you know, living it up. I was really getting used to the movie stuff. God. Oh. I've been here a long time, man. That looks like Kirk Corcoran coming up through there, you know. Him and Howard Hughes or somebody. Anyway, I was getting used to the movie star bitch, you know. I had a dark glasses on, you know, sitting in the back of a Cadillac limousine saying, I'm a movie star. I'm a zombie. Hey. So we're, you know, eating hamburgers and drinking Pepsi Colas. So I did that, you know, I was living it up, man. And then I got drafted. So so overnight, it was all gone, man. It was like it was a dream, you know. I was saying, was that me? Did it happen? You know. So all the guys in the service, they just watched me at first to see what I was going to do, you know. They said, what you going to do? I'm sitting around going, trying to play the rifle, you know. And so they just watched me first to see what I was going to do. And when they saw I was doing the same thing they were, everything was okay, you know. So, but the guys in the service must get awfully homesick because they call each other mother a lot. And they, I kind of picked it up, you know. Didn't go over too well back in Hollywood when I got out, you know. I'd go up to some director, how you doing, your mother? You know, get him out of here, man. He's a squirrel. So, so when I came back to Hollywood in 1960 and, oh, it's me. Then I did G.I. Blues and Blue Hawaii and Girls, Girls, Girls. So anyway, I got into a routine of making pictures and I was missing contact with the live audience. So that's why I'm back, and that's, I just want to tell you for myself.
The audience loved the closeness of the intimate performances, and their reaction to Elvis prompted him to open up even more.
I'd like to thank you. You're really a wonderful audience, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all very much.
Good evening.
By the time Elvis concluded his engagement, he had performed to over 101,000 grateful fans. After Elvis left his mark, Las Vegas would never be the same again.
One, two, three.
The following night, on August 29th, 1969, Nancy Sinatra attempted to fill the large void left by Elvis at the International. Her opening night performance was attended by Elvis, his wife Priscilla, the Colonel, and all their friends. Elvis enjoyed seeing other performers in Las Vegas when he could, especially friends like his former leading lady from the 1968 film Speedway. After the show, Elvis attended a party that was hosted by none other than Frank Sinatra. Free of his movie and recording commitments for the first time in years, Elvis spent the next 4 months relaxing and vacationing. Early January 1970, Elvis began rehearsals for his upcoming second season in Las Vegas. Opening night was January 26th. And the engagement ran until February 23rd. After another incredible engagement, a Los Angeles newspaper stated that the new decade will belong to Elvis. February 27th, 1970, Elvis performed the first two of six performances at the Houston Astrodome. These concerts marked the first time Elvis has performed outside of Las Vegas since 1961. His touring would continue later in the year, but for now, his focus was on his upcoming third engagement in Las Vegas at the International.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the big, freaky International Hotel.
A deal was made with MGM to film a live documentary that will eventually be called That's the Way It Is.
Good morning, Hollywood camera.
The rehearsals began in mid-July at MGM Studios in Culver City, California, and were also filmed for use in the documentary. Elvis rehearsed over 60 songs, and new arrangements and orchestrations were written for songs Elvis had just used in his last recording session. In preparation for the upcoming engagement that would be filmed by MGM, Colonel Parker started a large promotional campaign that would soon be known as the Elvis Presley Summer Festival. Opening night was on August 10th, and MGM filmed several performances through the first week. Fans came from all over the world to see the Elvis Presley show in Las Vegas. Elvis was in top form, and it was evident that he was putting 110% into every performance he gave. As the cameras rolled, they captured the true essence of the Elvis experience. Elvis rocked the audience with some of his biggest hits, and even performed a few songs recorded by other artists, like the Bee Gees' Words and the Righteous Brothers' You've Lost That Lovin' Feeling. Each song performed with a real conviction and passion. He was a real artist, always moving forward, finding brilliance in the work of others, and believing in the power of song. Also evident was the tremendous impact he had on the audience, who was captivated by the natural charisma and powerful stage presence of this legendary performer. That's the Way It Is was released in theaters nationwide in conjunction with the album, which contained some cuts from the actual shows, as well as cuts from the June 1970 session in Nashville. The album went gold, selling over 500,000 copies. That's the Way It Is, the film, was an instant success at the box office. Being his first concert documentary, people all over the world who had never actually witnessed a live Elvis performance, for the first time ever, was given a detailed look at the master at work. Although his films were entertaining, this was a first glimpse for many of the real Elvis at his very best. The new documentary was released in theaters close to the same time Elvis started touring the nation again in late 1970. This created an even bigger frenzy for concert tickets, as fans now had the opportunity to relive the magic at a live Elvis performance right in their hometown. What more could a fan ask for? The enormous overall success of That's the Way It Is can also be documented by the fact that Elvis sold over 14 million combined records in 1970. As filming for That's the Way It Is ended, the Las Vegas engagement continued for several more days. The tremendous surge of power and energy that hit Las Vegas a year earlier was still going just as strong as ever. The engagement was scheduled to close on September 7th, but the demand for tickets was so great, Elvis agreed to an additional 3 a.m. show on September 8th. After three extremely successful engagements, the Grateful International Hotel presented Elvis with a World Championship attendance record gold belt as a token of their appreciation. Elvis would proudly wear the belt at home and on stage for many years to come. Without so much as one day of rest, Elvis left the following day and flew directly to Phoenix, Arizona on September 9th, 1970, to start his first concert tour since 1957. The tour ended on September 14th in Mobile, Alabama. Between his last Las Vegas engagement and this new tour, Elvis performed nonstop for 36 days straight. The boy from Tupelo, who changed music forever, had accomplished most everything in life he set out to accomplish. From touring the country in the 50s and recording a long and distinguished line of gold records, to realizing his dream of making films in Hollywood, Elvis had done it all and was now returning full circle back to touring the nation and sharing his wonderful gift of song with those he loved the most, his fans.